And welcome to Digitalgov's Beginner's Guide to Getting Started with ATOs. I'm Lindsay Young, she/her pronouns. I work at 18F. We are federal employees that are part of the General Services Administration. We help other government agencies by partnering with them to build and buy software to improve public service through technology. Today, we'll be sharing practical advice for ATOs, or authorization to operate. The goal of this video is to help you authorize a system for the first time. We'll focus on the information that is most relevant to federal government employees. Slide 2. In this talk, we'll discuss: what is an ATO? Do I need an ATO? Roles and responsibilities, and how to authorize your system. Slide 3, disclaimer. All references to specific brands, products, and/or companies are used only for illustrative purposes and do not imply endorsement by the U.S. federal government or any federal government agency. Slide 4, what is an ATO? Slide 5, you need to complete an authorization to operate before you use, buy, or build software for the government. For most government workers, this is a mostly behind-the-scenes process for the tools that you use, but you may run across this process if you need to build or buy software. Slide 6, why do we have ATOs? Slide 7, there's no perfect risk-free system. The ATO process is aimed at minimizing and managing risk responsibility. ATOs can have a bad rap because they can feel very bureaucratic, but they can also be a good opportunity to take stock of what you have and how to make it better. Of course, there are ways to improve the system, and that could be an entire additional slide deck, but I can honestly say this process has made products I have been responsible for better, and I'm thankful for it. As an example, I'm going to refer to the GSA 18F process. This includes documentation, penetration testing or pen testing, signing an ATO, authority to operate, and POAM, plan of action and milestones. That's a plan to monitor and improve the security of your site. Slide 8, an ATO isn't sunshine and butterflies. But if you treat the exercise only as a paperwork exercise, you will be missing out on ways to improve your product. Improving privacy and security are ways to protect the people who use your products. You can also leverage this process as a way to encourage best practices for security and privacy. An ATO is not a piece of paper. It's a process. I'm adding this point in bold to make sure that the practices and standards that you set and define when you're getting an ATO don't go by the wayside once you have an initial approval. Slide 9, do I need an ATO? Slide 10, when it comes to ATOs, the fun is mandatory. The most likely way that you'll encounter an ATO is that you need an ATO before you use, buy, or build software in the government. Usually, this isn't an individual responsibility, but there are some use cases you should be aware of. Before you download or try out any new software for your government job, your agency might have an authorization to test process. It is better to ask if you're not sure. Ask about ATOs if you're buying software. Your contracting officers will know the specific requirements and procedures for your agency, but this is something that is helpful to think about up front. You'll need to have that ATO completed before your software can get used. Finally, you will need to get an ATO or update an existing one if you're building or using new software for a product or system. There are also plenty of other special use cases that we're not going to get into here. Slide 11, when do I need an ATO? So if you're building or buying software, you need an ATO before you can use it. Make sure you have those conversations with security team early in your process. And keep in mind, there's huge variation in how agencies approach ATOs. So having those conversations can get you prepared. Slide 12, key roles for an ATO. It takes many people to collaborate on an ATO, but there are three key roles to understand so you'll know who to talk to and what their responsibilities are. Slide 13, system owner. The system owner is usually responsible for the overall procurement, development, integration, modification, operation, maintenance, and retirement of a system. They will work with the team to create documentation, and they are responsible for making sure that the team makes security fixes in a timely manner. Slide 14, Information System Security Officer, or ISO. They need to research, develop, implement, test, and review an organization's information security. They assess the impacts on new systems and system modifications, review the ATO package, and they may have contracts for penetration testing, etc. This person usually works as a liaison to the agency's security team. Your agency may also have information system security managers, ISMs, supporting the ISO. Slide 15, authorizing official, AO. This person signs the memo that accepts the risk of a system. This person is personally liable for that risk. They will be your agency's chief information officer, CIO, or someone designated by the CIO. A huge part of the ATO process is aiming to educate the AO on what the risks to the system are. You'll also want to make sure your paperwork is detailed enough so that it can be a good resource if there's ever an audit. The risks that are being taken on here are not trivial. Slide 16, how to ATO your system. Slide 17, I like to group the ATO steps by what the main purpose of the activities are. First, you need to document your system. The purpose of this is to create a shared understanding of what your system is and what are the consequences if something were to go wrong. Second, you work with assessors to test and verify that the system is as documented and account for ways to reduce risk. Some of the risk reduction may be done after the initial ATO. It depends on the severity of the risk and agency policies. Third, when there is agreement that the system and policies are properly documented and the authorization official is comfortable signing off on any remaining risk, the ATO memo is signed. Finally, it is really important to note that the responsibilities continue. You need to follow through on the promises you made about your policies and procedures and that you're following them. You will want to monitor your system and continually plan on how to improve your security. Slide 18, step one, document. The objective is to create a shared understanding of your project among business, operational, and security teams. Slide 19. For ATO documentation, you will need a security impact level assessment to think about and document what kinds of risk are inherent in your system. I'll dive into this next. You'll need a privacy impact assessment to address the privacy implications of your system. This will be questions about the data that you're retaining and what your record requirements are. A very large document called a System Security Plan or System Security and Privacy Plan, and we'll dive into that later. And there are also additional requirements to ship software outside the ATO process. It's important that you know what the requirements are for your system and what those will be from the beginning. When you're beginning an ATO, you should also ask about these requirements so that you can do all of your documentation and testing together. There's a system of record notice, or SORN. And if you have a brand new system that contains information on individuals and retrieves that information by personal identifier, you'll likely need a SORN. PRA clearance, or Paperwork Reduction Act clearance. If your system is a new system or you're gathering new data and it will be collecting information from the public, you will probably need PRA clearance. 508 is accessibility testing for any interfaces or documents that are produced. Slide 20, FISMA levels. So the Federal Information Processing Standards, or FIPS 199 worksheet, will help you assess the security impact level. And this is a combination of how confidential the system and the data are. Are there secrets or private information that you need to protect? Is there personal identifiable information, or PII, contract data, or other special kinds of data? The importance of the system's data and integrity. What would the impacts of the system getting defaced? What could happen if the data was altered? Finally, the importance of the availability of the data. What are the impacts of things like downtime on your service? The system's security impact level, FISMA low, FISMA moderate, or FISMA high, will be the highest of those three questions listed. Keep in mind that this is a scale for the whole government. So this applies to many systems, from agencies such as the Nuclear Regulatory Agency or to the Marine Mammal Commission. You'll want to go by the questions in the worksheet and let that lead you to the answer. For example, your public information website may be important, but if there is a low risk to confidentiality, integrity, and availability, you won't want to overclassify it. Slide 21. For your system security plan, you will need a template document or access to documentation tool from your security team. Again, this is about communication. So giving them the information that they need in a format that works for them is a great practice. Getting clear expectations on what is expected of you can reduce the time of back and forth later, and that can be the biggest time suck in this process. In your SSP, you will estimate the system sensitivity. Refer to your FIPS 199 worksheet for that. You will need a system diagram. This is something that you'll want to have at the ready and keep up to date. You may also need data flow diagrams and additional diagrams. You need an overview of the types of users of your system. You may have some combination of public users, internal users, and administrators. You will want to make sure you are giving appropriate levels of access to each user group. Inventories of hardware, networks, and services. You'll need to make sure that you're documenting your technical setup. And security controls. These are specific security considerations that you need to think about, and I will dive into security controls next. Slide 22. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, is a standards body for a range of things, like the length of yardsticks, to example peanut butter, to information security controls. That is why I have a picture of a $300 jar of NIST peanut butter on the right. Controls are basically considerations for building secure software. Some controls can be covered by implementing software correctly, like making sure your site has the logs it needs. Other controls touch on policy or the human element. For example, someone needs to be responsible to make sure that accounts are being kept up to date and people don't have access to systems after they leave. Federal security compliance is based on evaluating security criteria. Those criteria are a wide-ranging set of considerations called controls. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, defines those controls in a special publication, 853. We're currently using revision 5. Slide 23. The higher the security impact level, the more controls your product will be responsible for. Some controls will be a shared responsibility, and some controls might not be applicable to your project. Usually, there's a team, person, or policy that will tell you what controls apply to your project, but this process varies widely across agencies. So make sure to clarify whose responsibility it is to choose or tailor controls. NIST controls can be where people's eyes start to glaze over. There are 325 controls for a FISMA moderate ATO. Most of those can be covered by your existing agency policies and products that you already are using that already have ATOs. Your app could be responsible for 26 to 56 controls depending on the app's FISMA level. Each control is a different type of security consideration. Through your SSP, the project explains how it will deal with each control. Some controls will already be taken care of by your agency or hosting platform. Slide 24, step 2, test and verify. Objective, look for vulnerabilities and make sure your SSP correctly documents your system and processes. Slide 25, assessment. During your assessment, your system security officer and or information security officer will review your SSP documentation and look for security vulnerabilities. Slide 26, example activities. This can include documentation review, scans such as OS Zap or NetSparker, checking that your software is up to date, and penetration testing. So these processes really do vary widely depending on who's doing your assessment, what your agency's policies are, and how risky your project is. You will probably need software scans to check for any software that's out of date and check that the system settings are secure. You may also need things like penetration testing, where a specialized security tester is authorized to try to exploit the system and find flaws. Slide 27, artifacts. We want to have proof that your system documentation is correct, proof that you are following your processes and policies outlined in your SSP, and these can be things like scan results, configuration settings, and screenshots. Some assessors want to make their own screenshots as you walk through a deployment. You might need images of approvals, etc. Again, this varies depending on the agency and what kind of system you're getting approved. Slide 28, document the remaining risk and improve. Your agency's security team usually supports projects with things like security scans and alerts when a software is using something dangerously out of date. When those issues come up, it's the system owner's responsibility to make sure software risks are addressed in a timely manner. The agency's security team will work with the system owner to document risks in a plan of actions and milestones, or POAM. This will record things like when software needs to be updated and when those updates are complete. Since there's no perfect system, teams need to continually track and mitigate security risks. Software needs updates as new threats are discovered. Slide 29, step 3, accept. Objective, someone signs off on the remaining risk. Slide 30, no joke. I framed the piece of paper when I got my first ATO memo. I have included a picture of myself for accessibility reasons. I am a white woman with blonde hair with a big smile on her face holding up an ATO memo. Once the assessment is in order, the authorizing official accepts the remaining risk. The ATO memo is signed by the ISO, AO, and system owner. Slide 31, continuous monitoring. Objective, look for new risks. Keep documentation up to date. Periodically verify controls are up to date and being addressed. Slide 32, remember, the ATO process doesn't end. You need to maintain your POAM, continue your scans, follow practices and policies that you laid out, remediate any issues that come up, amend your SSP when you make changes with that's called a significant change request, and renew or update your ATO based on your agency policy. Slide 33, join the web managers community at digitalgov/communities/web-content-managers to stay connected and receive the latest information and news about ATOs. Thank you.